Presenting a Vedic perspective on psychology, Sri Prabhupada discusses the subject with his disciple Shyamasundara in the following conversation, recorded in Calcutta on October 5, 1971. Srila Prabhupada says, by speculating on some shock that may or may not have occurred in childhood, one will never discover the root disease. Freud did not know the basic principle of spiritual understanding, which is that we are not this body. We are different from this body and we are transmigrating from one body to another. Shyamasundara. Sigmund Freud's idea was that many psychological problems originate with traumatic experiences in childhood or infancy. His method of cure was to have the patient try to recall these painful events and analyze them. Srila Prabhupada, but he did not know that one must again become an infant. After this life, one will be put into another womb and the same traumatic experience will happen again. Therefore, it is the duty of the spiritual master and the parents to save the child from taking another birth. The opportunity of this human form of life is that we can understand the horrible experiences of birth, death, old age, and disease, and act so that we shall not be forced to go through the same things again. Otherwise, after death, we shall have to take birth in a womb and suffer repeated miseries.
So basically here Swami Prabhupada is saying that if we are born and then we die, and again we have to take birth, and then we have to go through the same repeated miseries of birth and death. Yeah, continue.
Shyamasundara. Freud treated many people suffering from neurosis. For instance, suppose a man is sexually impotent. By recalling his childhood, he may remember some harmful experience with his father or mother that caused him to be repelled by women. In this way, he can resolve conflict and lead a normal sex life. Srila Prabhupada. However, even in the so-called normal condition, the pleasure derived from sexual intercourse is simply a frustrating and insignificant. For ordinary men attached to the materialistic way of life, their only pleasure is sexual intercourse. But the Shastras say, Ya maitunadi, the pleasure derived from the sexual intercourse is 10th class at best, because they have no idea of the pleasure of Krishna consciousness. The materialist regards sex as the highest pleasure. And how is it actually experienced? We have an itch and we scratch it. We feel pleasure, but the after effects of the pleasure are abominable. The mother has to undergo labor pains and the father has to take responsibility for raising the children nicely and giving them an education. Of course, if one is irresponsible like cats and dogs, that is another thing. But for those who are actually, gentlemen, it is not painful to bear and raise children, certainly. Therefore, everyone is avoiding children by contraceptive methods, but much better is to follow the injunction of these Shastras. Simply try to tolerate the itching sensation and avoid so much pain. This is real psychology. That itching sensation can be tolerated if one practices Krishna consciousness. Then one will not be attracted by the sex life.
Yeah, so Sigmund Freud is a psychologist, modern psychologist, and all of his philosophy is based on sex is the center of everything. And Srila Prabhupada is saying, but actually it is not the center. Without that, the life is much better, right? So he's talking about that we admit an embodied living being must have hunger and he must have sex impulse. Yes. We find it that even in animals, these impulses are there. So Freud believed that the ego tries to restrain these primitive drives and all anxieties arise from this conflict. Now continue reading. So Srila Prabhupada counters Freud's theory.
Freud's philosophy is that people...
The next one, our explanation.
Freud believed that the ego tries to restrain these primitive drives and all... and all anxieties arise from this conflict. Srila Prabhupada, our explanation is as follows. Materialistic life is no doubt very painful. As soon as one acquires a material body, he must always suffer three kinds of miseries. Miseries caused by other living beings, miseries caused by the elements, miseries caused by his own body and mind. So the whole problem is how to stop these miseries and attain permanent happiness. Unless one stops his materialistic way of life with its threshold miseries and repeated birth and death, there is no question of happiness. The whole Vedic civilization is based on how one can cure this materialistic disease. If we can cure this disease, its symptoms will automatically vanish. Freud is simply dealing with the symptoms of the basic disease. When you have a disease, sometimes you have headaches, sometimes you have leg aches, sometimes you have a pain in your stomach and so on. But if your disease is cured, then all your symptoms disappear. That is our program. Shyama Sundara. In his theory of psychoanalysis, Freud states that by remembering and reevaluating emotional shocks from our childhood, we can release the tension we are feeling now. Srila Prabhupada, but what is the guarantee that one will not get shocked again? He may cure the results of one shock, but there is no guarantee that the patient will not receive another shock. Therefore, Freud's treatment is useless. Our program is total cure. No more shocks of any kind. If one is situated in real Krishna consciousness, he can face the most severe type of adversity and remain completely undisturbed. In our Krishna consciousness moment, we are giving people this ability. Freud tries to cure the reactions of one kind of shock, but other shocks will come one after another. This is how material nature works. If you solve one problem, another problem arises immediately. And if you solve that one, another one comes. As long as you are under the control of material nature, these repeated shocks will come. But if you become Krishna consciousness, there are no more shocks.
Yeah, so now we are seeing all these shocks, right? Corona, police brutality, that Rajput, the Hindi film hero committing suicide. So many things. Because in material world, it's full of shocks. One after the other. It never ends. Joblessness, like another 1.5 million people have applied for unemployment. So it's very, very tough situation. So this theory of psychoanalysis and all those theories cannot really help us. That's what he's saying. Shyam Sundar is saying Freud said X, and Srila Prabhupada immediately cuts him down saying that, yeah, but there is, you know, the fundamental problem is not being solved. The fundamental problem is that we have taken birth in this material world and we have to take birth again and again. Unless we solve this repeated birth and death, we have actually not solved the problem. So this is a short excerpt from one of Srila Prabhupada's books, which gives you some insight on how Prabhupada talked not just about Krishna, but about all these other philosophies, right? About Darwinism. In the same book, there is something about Darwinism also. Let's go there. Darwin, maybe. So, yeah, read this, Karthik.
Devotee. Darwin tried to show how the origin of living species could be fully explained by the purely mechanical unplanned action of natural forces. But the process he called natural selection, all the higher complex forms of life gradually evolved from more primitive and rudimentary ones. In a given animal population, for example, some individuals will have traits that make them adapt better to their environment. These more fit individuals will survive to pass on their favorite traits to their offspring. The unfit will gradually be weeded out naturally. Thus, a cold climate will favor those who have, say, long hair or fatty tissue, and the species will then gradually evolve in that direction. Srila Prabhupada, the question is that in the development of the body, is there any plan that a particular kind of body with, as you say, long hair or fatty tissue should exist under certain natural conditions? Who has made these arrangements? That is the question. Devotee, no one. Modern evolutionists ultimately base their theory on the existence of chance variations. Srila Prabhupada, that is nonsense. There is no such thing as chance. If they say chance, then they are nonsense. Our question remains, who has created the different circumstances for the existence of different kinds of animals? Devotee, for example, a frog may lay thousands of eggs, but out of all of them, only a few may survive to adulthood. Those who do are more fit than the others. If the environment did not favorably select the fittest, then too many frogs. Srila Prabhupada, yes, frogs and many other animals lay eggs by the hundreds. A snake gives birth to crores of snakes at a time, and if they all were allowed to exist, there would be a great disturbance. Therefore, big snakes devour the small snakes. That is nature's law. But behind nature's law is a brain. That is our proposition. Nature's law is not blind, for behind it there is a brain, and that brain is God. We learn this from Bhagavad Gita, chapter 9, verse 10. Mayadhyakshana
prakriti swete sacharacharam
swete cha saranacharam.
Characharam. Roaming. Achara means not roaming. So characharam, moving and non-moving entities like that.
Whatever is taking place in material nature is being directed by the Supreme Lord, who maintains everything in order. So the snake lays eggs by the score, and if they were not killed, the world would be overwhelmed by snakes. Similarly, male tigers kill the cubs. The economic theory of Malthus states that whenever there is overpopulation, there must be an outbreak of war, epidemic, famine, or the like to curb it. These natural activities do not take place by chance, but are planned. Anyone who says they are a matter of chance has insufficient knowledge. Devotee, but Darwin has a huge amount of evidence. Srila Prabhupada, evidence? That is all right. We also have got evidence. Evidence must be there. But as soon as there is evidence, there should be no talk of chance. Devotee, for example, out of millions of frogs, one may happen to be better adapted to living in the water. Srila Prabhupada, but that is not by chance, that is by plan. He doesn't know that. As soon as one says chance, it means his knowledge is imperfect. A man says chance when he cannot explain. It is evasive. So the conclusion is that he is without perfect knowledge and therefore unfit for giving any knowledge. Is stating, and that's all. Devotee, well, Darwin sees a plan or design in a sense, but Srila.
Yeah, Srila Prabhupada.
If he sees a plan or design, then whose design? As soon as you recognize a design, you must acknowledge a designer. If you see a plan, then you must accept a planner that he does not know. Devotee, but the plan is the involuntary working of nature. Srila Prabhupada, nonsense. There is a plan. The sun rises daily according to the exact calculation. It does not follow or calculate. Rather, we calculate according to the sun. Experiencing that in such and such season the sun rises at such and such time, we learn that according to the season the sun will rise exactly on the minute, the second. It is not by whimsy or chance, but by minute plan.
Minute plan, not minute, minute means a small plan.
Devotee, but can't you say it's just mechanical? Srila Prabhupada, then who made it mechanical? If something is mechanical, then there must be a mechanic, a brain, who made the machine. Here is something mechanical. Prabhupada points to a telex machine. Who made it? This machine did not come by itself. It is made of iron, and the iron did not mold itself into a machine. Then there is a brain who made the machine possible. So everything in nature has a plan or design. And behind that plan or design is a brain, a very big brain.
So what Prabhupada is saying is that as Darwin and the Darwinists claim that everything came by chance, he's saying everything didn't come by chance. When you say there is a plan, means there should be a planner. When you say there is a design, means there should be a designer. When you say it is mechanical, then there must be a mechanic. And that person, the designer, the planner, and the mechanic, has a very, very big brain, because he's doing things in a very large scale, right? How big is the universe? 4 billion miles wide. So even the designer has to think in that large scale, right? So that is the total idea. Because a lot of times people say, including people who come from pious Indian backgrounds, they say, oh, Darwin's theory. But Darwin himself never said that everything is known. But people hang on to his theory as if it were a fact. No, his theory is actually inconclusive, and there are a lot of gaps in it. So that's what Prabhupada is saying. There is a planner, there is a designer, there is a big brain, and that big brain is Krishna or God. So we talked about psychoanalysis, where Sigmund Freud was talking about, you know, how people's psychology is evolving. But Srila Prabhupada cut him down, saying that he is only thinking about the body, not about the soul. So when we think on the soul platform, obviously we can see bigger things. Otherwise, it will always remain a challenge. Any questions on that one? They're two very important topics, because one talks about psychological aspect, the other talks about biological aspect. So in this way, Swami Prabhupada talks about a lot of these scientific notions, and he compares them with Vedic notions. Any thoughts on that? Comments, questions? Okay. Then he talks about universe also, right? The unseen controller. Okay, Sheshdev, please read this one.
Even the most complicated computers need trained men to handle them. Similarly, we should know that this great machine, which is known as the cosmic manifestation, is manipulated by a supreme spirit, and that is Krishna. In an excerpt from his book, Krishna Consciousness, the Matchless Gift, Srila Prabhupada offers intriguing insights into how God creates and controls the universe. The purpose of this Hare Krishna movement is to bring man back to his original consciousness, which is Krishna consciousness, clear consciousness. When water falls from the clouds, it is uncontaminated, like distilled water. But as soon as it touches the ground, it becomes muddy and is discolored. Similarly, we are originally pure spirit soul, part and parcel of Krishna, and therefore our original constitutional position is as pure as God's. In Bhagavad Gita, chapter 15, verse 7, Sri Krishna says, Mama evam so jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatanaha mana sasthani indriyani prakriti sthani karshati. The living entities in this conditioned world are my eternal fragmental parts. Due to conditioned life, they are struggling very hard with the six senses, which include the mind. Thus all living entities are part and parcel of Krishna. It should always be remembered that when we speak of Krishna, we are speaking of God, because the name Krishna denotes the all-attractive supreme personality of Godhead. As a fragment of gold is qualitatively the same as a gold reservoir, so the minute particles of Krishna's body are therefore qualitatively as good as Krishna. The chemical composition of God's body and the eternal spiritual body of the living entity is the same, spiritual. Thus, originally, in our uncontaminated condition, we possessed a form as good as God's. But just as rain falls to the ground, so we come in contact with this material world, which is manipulated by the external energy or material nature. When we speak of external energy or material nature, the questions may be raised, whose energy, whose nature? Material energy or nature is not active independently. Such a concept is foolish. In the Bhagavad Gita, it is clearly stated that material nature does not work independently. When a foolish man sees a machine, he may think that it is working automatically, but actually it is not. There is a driver, someone in control. Although we sometimes cannot see the controller behind the machine due to our defective vision. There are many electronic mechanisms which work very wonderfully, but behind these intricate systems is a scientist who pushes the button. This is very simple to understand. Since a machine is matter, it cannot work on its own accord, but must work under spiritual direction. A tape recorder works, but it works according to the plans and under the direction of a living entity, a human being. The machine is complete, but unless it is manipulated by a spirit soul, it cannot work. Similarly, we should understand that this cosmic manifestation, which we call nature, is a great machine, and that behind this machine, there is God, Krishna. This is all affirmed in Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says...
So again, like psychology, Swami Prabhupada countered Freud's argument. In biology, he countered Darwin's argument. And in cosmology or astronomy, he's countering modern scientists' argument that everything is being done automatically. It cannot be done automatically. You may think it is getting done automatically, but there has to be that supreme spirit who is actually running the show. So nothing is really automatic. So, yeah, continue.
This is also affirmed in Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, Maya jakshena prakriti suyasdesa characharam hetunanena kaunteya jagat viparivartate. This material nature, which is one of my energies, is working under my direction, O son of Kunti, producing all the moving and non-moving beings. Under its rule, this manifestation is created and annihilated again and again. Bhagavad Gita chapter 9 verse 10. So Krishna says that material nature is acting under his direction. Thus behind everything there is a supreme controller. Modern civilization does not understand this due to lack of knowledge. It is the purpose of this society for Krishna consciousness, therefore, to enlighten all people who have been maddened by the influence of the three modes of material nature. In other words, our aim is to awaken mankind to its normal condition. There are many universities, especially in the United States, and many departments of knowledge, but they are not discussing these points. Where is the department for this knowledge that we find given by Sri Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita? When I spoke before some students and faculty members at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, the first question I raised was, where is the technology technological department which is investigating the difference between a dead man and a living man. When a man dies, something is lost. Where is the technology to replace it? Why don't scientists try to solve this problem? Because this is a very difficult subject matter. They set it aside and busily engage in the technology of eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. However, the Vedic literatures inform us that this is animal technology. Animals are also trying their best to eat well, to have an enjoyable sex life, to sleep peacefully, and to defend themselves. What then is the difference between... man's knowledge and the animal's knowledge? The fact is that man's knowledge should be developed to explore that difference between a living body and a dead body. That spiritual knowledge was imparted by Krishna to Arjuna in the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita. Being a friend of Krishna's, Arjuna was a very intelligent man, but his knowledge, as all men's, was limited. Krishna spoke, however, of subject matters which were beyond Arjuna's finite knowledge. These subjects are called adhokshaja because our direct perception by which we acquire material knowledge fails to approach them. For example, we have many powerful microscopes to see what we cannot see with our limited vision, but there is no microscope that can show us the soul within the body. Nevertheless, the soul is there. The Bhagavad Gita informs us that in this body, there is a proprietor, the spirit soul. In the proprietor of my body and other souls are the proprietors of their bodies. I say my hand, but not I hand. Since it is my hand, I am different from the hand because its owner, being its owner. Similarly, we speak of my eye, my leg, my this, my that. In the midst of all these objects which belong to me, where am I? The search for the answer to this question is the process of meditation. In real meditation, we ask, where am I? What am I? We cannot find the answers to these questions by any material effort. And because of this, all the universities are setting these questions aside. They say it is too difficult a subject, or they brush it aside. It is irrelevant.
Yeah, so pause there for a moment. So Rajalakshmi, you were saying, right? When you go deep into meditation, the question is, where is this? What is this? I don't even have a body, right? Where am I? What am I? Those are the philosophical questions that come about. So when we say hand, you say my hand, you don't say I hand. Because my hand means I am different from the hand, I am different from the leg, I am different from my body, I am the soul. So now he's talking about the fourth topic, the science of the soul. So in this book is a very interesting book. It's called Theory of Self-Discovery. And in this, early on, he countered Sigmund Freud's psychological theories. Then he countered Darwin's biological evolutionary theory. Then he countered modern scientists' planetary systems and cosmology theory. Now he is countering the theory or science of the soul. So, yeah, there are so many things that modern scientists claim to be a fact, but they are just theories. And we, like foolish people, whatever theory they throw at us, we immediately think that that must be a fact. And we, quickly jump into the conclusion that that is the way the world works, right? So let's go and see one of the videos where they talk about reincarnation. There are 10 people who actually showed that they are not the body, but they are the soul. I think this is the one. There are many reincarnation. This is one of those videos. Let's see what this is.
K-12 powered students have great teachers too.
My favorite is my math.